The last talk in this session will be given by Suli Young, who's a student at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. She'll be talking about split-level I/O scheduling.
Hello, everyone. I'm Suli Young, and today I'm going to talk about split-level I/O scheduling. This work is done in University of Wisconsin-Madison with my colleagues Tyler, Nishant, Samer, Salini, Anand, Rini, and our advisors, Andrea and Remzi. Well, some of you may already got bored by the title because, well, let's face it, this is the last session of the conference. And I/O scheduling has already been studied extensively in the past decades. We have a lot of I/O papers about I/O scheduling. And on top of that, we have even more I/O schedulers. For example, we have CFQ, BFQ, YFQ, and other FQs, and deadline scheduler, and more recent ones, including mClock, pClock, token bucket for isolation, Libra for key value store, Farhead, and Farhead. Well, it turns out that there is some mistakes that we have been making for decades, some fundamental mistakes when we are trying to build better schedulers. What we do find is that the current scheduling frameworks are fundamentally limited. We have looked at different schedulers, including the most common one, like CFQ, deadline, token bucket. We have found that important policies inherently just cannot be realized within the current framework, including the most desirable policies such as fairness, latency guarantees, or performance isolation. So any effort of trying to build new schedulers without fixing the problem of the underlying framework is deemed to go wasted. So what this talk is about is we're asking this question, can we actually build a simple and effective framework that lets us to build schedulers that actually correctly realize whatever policies we want to realize? To this end, we propose the split-level I/O scheduling framework. It gives more control to the scheduler by allowing a centralized scheduler to schedule at multiple levels, namely the block level, the system call level, and the page cache level. We also provide more information to the scheduler by tagging each I/O request with its originating applications. And it turns out we can achieve those without losing simplicity. We do this by exposing a small set of hooks within the key junctions of the storage stack. So implementing a new scheduler is still just a matter of implementing a few hooks, not re-engineering the whole storage stack. So here I give an overview of our results. We have implemented three distinct policies under our framework: the priority scheduling, deadline, and performance isolation. We observe large performance improvements. The scheduler under our framework can improve fairness by more than 12 times, reduce tail latency by 4 times, and improve isolation by more than 6 times. We have also found that split-level scheduling is good foundation for applications. It can reduce transaction latencies for databases, improve isolation for virtual machines, and also does effective rate limit for distributed file systems. Here is an overview of my talk. I first try to give some background information of what is an I/O scheduling framework and how does it work. And then I'm going to talk about the design of split-level scheduling framework. After that, I'm going to present two case studies of split-level schedulers. And finally, I'm going to conclude. So what is the difference between an I/O scheduling framework and an I/O scheduler? Basically, a framework offers a running environment in which individual schedulers can operate. Framework is the operating system's mechanism to pass control and provide information to individual schedulers, versus each scheduler will implement its own scheduling policies. This comes from the conventional wisdom of system design, where we try to separate mechanism and policy. And IO scheduling framework works by exposing callbacks to the schedulers in which they can implement. Let me illustrate by talking about how block level scheduling framework works. This is a traditional approach of providing IO scheduling in many operating systems, including Windows, Linux, FreeBSD, and others. So we all know that there are many layers in a storage stack. The application sits on top, and beneath there's page cans, file system, block level queues, and on the bottom we have IO devices. Well, a block level framework works by providing hooks at a block layer, namely where a block level request is being added to the queue, where the request is being dispatched to the underlying devices, and finally, when a request is being completed by the device. Let's look at how a typical scheduler can be implemented under such a framework. We will take safe queue, complete fair queuing as an example. This is the default IO scheduler in Linux. What safe queue tries to do is try to allocate IO resources fairly among processes based on their priority. So you can imagine in an end request hook, what safe queue will do is then will first try to find the process which submits the request. It will find the corresponding queue of that process and then it will enqueue the request. At some later time, probably when the device is idle, the safe queue will try to dispatch some request. It does so by first try to find the highest priority queue and then dequeue a request. And then send that request to the underlying devices. And finally, when the request is completed by the IO device, safe queue might do some cleaning up and final accounting. Okay, now that we know how IO scheduling framework and works and how a schedule might be implemented under such a framework, let's look at the design of our framework, the split level scheduling. I'm going to talk about this by talking about how split level framework overcomes three fundamental problems of the block level scheduling, namely the reordering problem, the cost mapping problem, and the cost estimation problem. So the ability to reorder is fundamental for any schedulers because, well, scheduling is basically just a matter of reordering requests so that whatever request which is more important to your scheduling goal are served first. For example, a deadline scheduler might want to reorder so that those requests which are about to expire the deadlines are served first. Well, it turned out that when you are operating at the block level, the file system on top of you may cause you some trouble. The first problem is data entanglement. I'm going to illustrate by example. Let's say that you have two applications. Application one issues some low priority writes, indicated by the light orange box. And application two issues some high priority writes, indicated by the darker orange box. Well, I mean, file system, because it has its own machineries and internal data structures, might entangle those different pieces of data together. There are different mechanisms in which file system may do this. For example, those two pieces of data may get grouped to the same journal transaction, or those two pieces of data may simply share a common metadata block. Well, turned out it causes problem to the underlying block level scheduler because if the scheduler wants to give some differential treatment based on the different types of data, it cannot do so because the file system on top of it has already entangled the data. So to summarize, it is impossible for the scheduler to reorder when the data gets entangled in the file system on top. Another problem comes from write dependencies. We all know that modern file systems carefully order their writes in order to maintain data consistencies. And there are different mechanisms of doing it. For example, journal transaction, copy and write, soft updates. But they all involve carefully ordering writes. And this may cause problem for the block level scheduler. Let's again look at an example. Here, let's say that we have some low priority data already sitting in the file system. And application issues some high priority data. Well, the file system, because it wants to maintain its own data consistency, even when there are power outages and crashes, it will group those data into journal transactions. Well, let's say that the low priority data gets put in transaction one versus the high priority data gets put in transaction two. This is a problem for the underlying I/O scheduler because for its own data consistency, the file system will have to finish transaction one before it starts write transaction two to the disk. Well, however, what the scheduler wants to do is that we want to schedule so that a high priority data gets to disk first. It is impossible for the scheduler to do so because, well, the high priority data is still being withheld by the file system, and the file system will not issue that request to the block level scheduler until we have finished all the low priority writes. So just to summarize, file system will carefully order writes, and that causes the scheduler's ability to reorder I/O requests unless the file system on top of it allows it. So here comes the first fundamental limitation of block level scheduling. Basically, the file system imposes ordering requirements, which might be contrary to the scheduling goal. And the schedulers, which operates underneath the file system, cannot reorder unless the above file system allows it. So, and we can say that it is already too late when you allow file system into, when you allow data into the file system. Because, well, once data is in the file system, data entanglement and all the ordering requirements has already happened. So what we do need is a mechanism for the scheduler to admission control data into file system before all those things happen. So in light of that, we introduce multiple layer hooks in split level scheduling framework. Namely, in addition to the traditional block level hooks, we add hooks at the system call level, in particular the write system call and the fsync system call. So because we have hooks above the file system, now it is possible for the scheduler to avoid data entanglement and ordering by simply not allowing the data into the file system. Another problem of block level scheduling is a cost mapping problem. In order to provide any kind of differentiated services to different applications, a scheduler has to be able to map an I/O request back to its original application. Well, however, file system does write delegation. I mean, again, let me show you by an example. Here we have two applications, and application one is issuing write system call, which dirties some pages in the memory, and it will return as soon as the memory is dirtied, and application two will do the same. Well, note that once the write system call has returned, the cost information has already lost. At the memory level, there's no way for us to actually know which application dirtied that metadata and is ultimately responsible for the I/O being caused. And later, the write back thread will come along, and it will basically go through all the memory cache and flush the dirty pages to disk. And we can see, from the block level scheduler's perspective, all the requests seems to be coming from the write back thread instead of the original application who requested the I/O service. Write back is just one mechanism of write delegation, where the process which submits requests may not be the process which is actually responsible for the I/O, and there are other mechanisms which can cause write delegation. For example, journaling and delayed allocation and others. So here comes the second fundamental limitation of block level scheduling, namely the cost map information is lost within the framework. So it is impossible for you to map an IO request back to its responsible application, no matter how you implement that scheduler. We solve this problem by adding some additional information, tags, to the IO request. Here again, we have application issue writes. When the application is starting the memory page, we add some additional information, namely the tag to each dirty pages to identify which application actually dirties the memory, as we can see here. So we have tags which identify the originating application. And later, when the write back thread comes along and try to flush dirty pages to disk, we will pass that tag information to the block level request, which is being submitted by the write back thread. So the tags are passed across layers from the page cache layer to the file system and to the underlying block level scheduler. As we can see here, because of the tag information, the scheduler is able to get the cost information no matter which layer of the storage stack. So there's cost estimation problem where a scheduler needs to estimate the cost of an IO in a timely and accurate fashion. And it turns out that the block level scheduler does not allow you to do so. I'm not going to talk about it here, but I encourage you to look at our paper if you are interested. So to summarize, there are three key pieces in our split level scheduling framework. We add multiple layer hooks to allow more control for the scheduler and to prevent, so that they can prevent adverse file system interactions. We add tags to each IO request to track cost information across layers. And finally, we have early memory level notifications of write work for scheduler to do better cost estimation. It turned out that it's a pretty easy implementation. The framework is just 300 lines of code within the Linux kernel code base. And as we will show later, there's little added complexity in building new schedulers under our framework. Now let me talk about two case studies of split level scheduler. First, let's take the challenge of can we build a priority scheduler, which tries to fairly allocate resources based on processes' priorities. Well, again, let's look at SafeQL, which is basically Linux's solution to it, and to the block layer. Notice the line in red. As we already talked about, the process which submits the IO request may not be the process which is actually responsible for it. So SafeQL might end up finding the wrong process and basically enqueue the request to the wrong queue, and that compromises its whole scheduling work. In order to test this, we set up 8 processes with different priorities, ranging from 0 to 7, with 0 being the highest, each sequentially write to its own file. In the x-axis, we show different priorities, and in the x-axis, we show the throughput each process gets. If everything works as expected, what we expect to see is that higher priority process gets higher throughput, as indicated by the goal line in red. Well, what we do see by SafeQL is that SafeQL is not respecting priority at all. We can say that higher priority process is not getting any kind of preferable treatment. Well, the right graph shows why. Again, in the x-axis, we show different priorities. And in the y-axis, we show the percentage of IO requests at each priority as seen by SafeQL. As we can see that even though there are processes of different priorities issuing writes, from SafeQL's perspective, all the requests seem to be at priority 4. Why? Turned out 4 is the default IO priority of the write back thread. And as SafeQL is saying, all the requests seem to be coming from the write back thread. So there's no way for SafeQL to map IO requests back to different thanks to the process of different priority and SAS respect priority, as it should do. Okay, here we can see we introduce AFQ, which stands for actual fair queuing. We can see that, we don't really have to change many code in CFQ. Instead of looking at the process which submits request, we simply look at the tag information we have along with each request. By adding these minor changes, we were able to respect priority as seen by the graph. AFQ is actually even though CFQ divides from the goal by 82%, AFQ divides just by 7%. This is 12 times improvement for fairness over CFQ. Okay, the second challenge is, can we implement a deadline scheduler, which actually provides guaranteed latency for IO requests? This is very important, for example, the database applications. Well, as we mentioned earlier, the block level deadline cannot really serve the low latency requests until the previous transaction has completed. And because file system sits on top of a scheduler, it might fill previous transaction with a lot of long latency requests, and there's no way for the scheduler to prevent that. Again, we are going to test by an experiment where we have a workload in which we try to flash 4 kilobytes of data to disk with or without background writes. What we expect to see is that the operation finishes within deadline, which we set to 100 milliseconds. here we show the results with the block level deadline scheduler. In the x-axis is the time, and starting from 30 seconds, we add some background writes. And in the y-axis, we show the operation latencies. We can see that even though when there's no background writes going on, the block deadline scheduler is able to observe the deadlines. When there's some background writes and the file system sometimes schedule the background writes before the foreground flashes, the latency actually increases 100 times. Well, I mean, this can be prevented in the split level framework. In our split deadline scheduler, what we do is that we implement hooks and write an async system call layer so that we block those system calls to prevent high latency data into file system when needed. So here, without those interference of those non-latency data, we are able to actually schedule the data we want to the block level scheduler and finally to the I/O devices. So basically, in the split deadline, what we try to do is that we suspend writing async system calls to avoid many high latency requests accumulate in one transaction. And again, we show the results. We can see that even the block deadline is not able to observe the the I/O request deadlines, our split deadline scheduler is able to maintain the deadline of I/O requests regardless of whether there is background writes going on or not. Okay, now let's talk about how split deadline is able to solve the async freeze problem. Basically, during checkpointing, the database system will try to begin writing out the data that needs async so aggressively that the service time for I/O requests from other processes goes through the roof. This comes from Robert Hess, who is the principal engineer of PostgreSQL. Well, as we can see, this is pretty much the same problem we talk about, right? where some background checkpointing data is being scheduled by the file system before the foreground transactions. And as we can see here, we try to run SQLite transactions with different checkpoint intervals. What we expect is some consistent transaction latency. Here in the x-axis, we vary how many dirty buffers we allow in the system before we trigger a checkpoint. And the y-axis is the transaction latency. We show the 2.9 and 3.9 tail latencies. As we can see, when there are more and more data being flushed during a checkpoint, the 3.9 tail latency is increased dramatically, actually more than 4 times. Versus in our three-level deadline, we are able to maintain a consistent transaction latency regardless of how many background writes are going on. So basically, we see a 4 times tail latency reduction. And split-level deadline schedule is actually a simple solution to the async freeze problem, which has been bothering the database community for a long time. So we have other evaluation results, which shows that we have low overhead of the framework, nascent 1% runtime overhead. And we implement other schedulers, namely the token bucket for performance isolation. We have shown that our scheduler is able to provide latency guarantees for PostgreSQL TPC workloads, provide isolation across virtual machines, and does effective I/O rate limit for HDFS. So here, now I come to my conclusion. For decades, people have been trying to build better block-level schedulers. However, such endeavor is bound to fail without appropriate framework support. So what we do in our split framework is to enable actually correct schedule implementation. There are three key pieces: cross-layer tags, multiple-level hooks for more controls, and memory-level notifications. The source code and more information can be found in our website. And with that, I'm happy to take questions.
Any questions?
Austin Clements, Google. Have you thought about applying this in a virtualized setting? So some of the schedulers that you mentioned work at a hypervisor layer and seem like they wouldn't be able to hook into the sort of more semantic information higher up in the stack.
That is an excellent question, actually. Actually, this work started because we want to do I/O scheduling in virtualized environment. We try to kind of pass different priorities from virtual machines to the host. Well, then we found out that priority scheduling doesn't even work in a single host system. And that's what led to this work. But yeah, definitely, when you have basically, this work is about you need to basically integrate multiple layers in order to achieve your scheduling goal. And when you have more layers in a storage stack, as you said, in a virtualized environment or even in a distributed system, I think you can really extend the spirit of split level scheduling in kind of more layers in a storage stack.
Stick around, we have a few closing words from the program chair.
A very few closing words. I just want to say thank you for everybody for coming. Thank you for everybody who gave awesome talks through everything, and safe journeys back. Hope to see you next time in 2017. Bye-bye.